We're joined this afternoon by Cyril Shroff, Managing Partner at Cyril Amarchand Mangaldas. Mr. Shroff, good afternoon. This is Bloomberg Quint. You're speaking with Menaka and Ira and Harsha in studio as well. I'll start off with the first question. There is considerable amount of debate on whether the government has done the right thing by promoters. More importantly, whether they've done the right thing when it comes to price discovery of an asset by leaving promoters out. My counter to that would be that promoters still have a window of opportunity. If they're able to pay the overdues, they can still participate, be eligible and participate in the bidding process, submit a resolution plan. Do you think that is enough?
So let me comment on three things, Menaka. One is on the sort of political consciousness of this and the political message surrounding this. The second on the commercial aspects, which includes some of the points that you just made. And the third, I think, is unintended consequences. So as far as just the political positioning of this, it sounds right because I think there is an atmosphere in the country just now about defaulting promoters being sort of bad guys. And because they are so-called bad guys, they should not be allowed to take any benefit from this process because they could effectively land up getting the assets cheap or at least with the banks incurring some losses and the end state with the promoters being sort of back in the saddle. So just from a very loose emotional public opinion perspective, it kind of sounds right, even though this is somewhat unusual in comparison with other insolvency regimes across the world. So it's a bit of a Indian extension over here, taken in the light of the fact that Indian businesses are, many of them are sort of promoter controlled. So I think the political messaging of it seems to be over here, and I think there are two narratives on this. The other narrative is why should they not, so long as they are participating pari passu with anybody else who could. Let me then come to the commercial aspects. From a commercial aspect, the fact that you're taking out one of the serious potential contenders, naturally the more you limit the number of participants, price discovery could be lower. And that you have to sort of trade off with the moral hazard of the promoters being allowed to come in. But here on the commercial aspect, I want to now take a slight detour on the unintended consequence. And this is still a very early reading of the ordinance. There's a lot of reflection and fine print reading that has yet to be done. In my first look at this ordinance, in the enthusiasm to expand and be comprehensive about the list of people who could be disqualified from participating, I think it has gone so far that you might actually be landing up hitting a lot of genuine, what were thought to be independent bidders, because they might have some connection somewhere or the other with people who may be tainted in this perspective as well. I don't think that has been properly thought through, and I think it's going to pose some practical challenges as we go. So I'm not going to take any names, but there is a fine balance between being comprehensive and having a footprint of disqualification that could include people you never intended to cover as well. And I think there's a serious problem over here. So that is problem number two. Now on, so as you go down the list of disqualifications as well, I think there could be some part of the sort of unintended consequences theme. I think there are areas which should have been clarified as well. Now coming specifically to the point of the window of opportunity, the window of opportunity is somewhat to be found in this new clause 29AC, which talks about the ability to it's sort of an exception to the disqualification, where there's a reference to failure to make payment of all overdue amounts with interest thereon and charges relating to the non-performing asset. So what is unclear is the fact as to whether this cure, if I can call it that, applies to the asset that is the subject matter of the insolvency and the NCLT case, or is it some other asset? So who are you disqualifying over here? Are you disqualifying a resolution applicant who has a problem somewhere else in his group? Or are you disqualifying the party who is actually got, or disqualifying the entity which is the subject matter of question? So this requires some clarification as well. But I don't see a logic in if somebody were to show up with a check at the door, whether it's the company itself or the promoter, and saying, okay, here is the money, why should they be disqualified? Because it serves the purpose of the price discovery, it serves the purpose of getting the lenders their dues, and you have solved the problem with the threat of this process. So I'll stop here for a second and take any further questions.
All right, thanks. I have one further question. I'll pass it on to my colleagues thereafter. I think you've, in describing the inability to interpret finally the fine print of that particular provision, you've also answered the question that someone asked me on Twitter last night, and that question was in two parts. One is, if you had a default in one asset, does that disqualify you from being able to cure any other asset, as you pointed out the word cure? And secondly is, does this still leave the scope open for Ms. Promoter A of asset B, which is an insolvency, to bid for asset C? And so basically two promoters of two different projects bidding for each other's projects, because they'd be disqualified as bidders for their own projects, yes, but not necessarily disqualified as bidders for somebody else's project. Now, I don't know in what condition, would Bhushan Steel want to buy Monnet Ispat and Monnet Ispat buy Bhushan Steel? Yeah, I'm so referring to the promoters. I don't know if that's true, but I'll ask you the question nonetheless.
So I think there is a drafting problem here.
Okay.
Which needs to be clarified, and what the intention needs to be clear as to, who are you trying to disqualify? Are you trying to disqualify anybody who in his Janam Patri has a sort of an NPA, or are you disqualifying the promoter in that particular case? So these questions will arise, and I think the effort just now as all practitioners in this area is to get as much clarity as possible. So now we appear on for different roles in this. We sometimes act for creditors, sometimes we act for resolution professional, and sometimes we act for buyers. I think ambiguity is the enemy of clarity over here. And what we need now in the bankruptcy regime today is extreme clarity, because any ambiguity could lead to a challenge in court.
Mr. Shroff, for
and of course, sorry, until that ambiguity comes from the legislation or the regulators, we'll have to interpret it as we go along.
Okay. Just one question, Mr. Shroff. For an honest promoter today, who is not allowed to participate in the bidding process, one, what are the options that he has? What are the legal options that he has? And do you see a protracted legal battle, promoter challenging the ordinance, promoter challenging banks? And does the timeline of this process, is that at risk?
See, I think there are going to be a lot of grumpy faces with this ordinance. So someone is going to have a go at it, for sure. And I mean, I was reading this morning's newspaper, and already people are talking about some of the challenges to this as well. So to answer your question, is somebody likely to challenge it? I think the answer is yes. Particularly because of the manner, it would be perceived as a bit high-handed, because at one blow you've kind of barred, as you say, an honest promoter from coming back. And unfortunately or fortunately, whatever may be the intention, this does not make a distinction between an honest defaulter and a not so honest defaulter. There's a wide list of categories which includes the whole kitchen sink.
Mr. Shroff, a question from the creditor standpoint, just because you would have dealt, with them and probably understand their thinking far better than we do. From their perspective, from everything we've gathered from them, they see this as, positive in terms of, the credit culture, the establishment of the creditor-debtor relationship, etc. All of those, I understand, are intangibles. But they also realize that in a tangible scenario, they may see lower recoveries from some of these assets. Which of those two, arguments would you buy more in the current scenario, knowing also very well the quality of the assets that are out there right now for insolvency?
No, I think that it's very clear. It's clear from the preamble to the ordinance as well, is that the imperative of this was political and the moral hazard issue, and not a commercial consideration. So, it sort of gets a tick on the public opinion, moral hazard, political messaging, but it does thus complicate it. Now, I am all in favor of a clear, efficient bankruptcy regime. So I am a great believer in the new code, but given how complex this this area is, and with so many stakeholders being involved, I think it will always have to be tempered by not only clarity, but a fine, nuanced balancing of interests. And potentially, I think there are parts of this which go overboard.
All right, that's a fair assessment, sir, because we've heard many different voices. In fact, earlier this morning, we had Anil Singhvi in a very fiery conversation with us tell us how, in fact, this opens the door for other bidders, that is the non-promoter bidders, to game the system. Because by taking away the promoter from the bidding system, A, you're hurting price discovery, and B, you're making it much easier for them to be able to gain assets. I just have one counter to all of this. I understand that we should not mix commercial wisdom and commercial sense and commercial legislation, more importantly, with emotions of any sort or vindictiveness or the attempt to say, hey, you know, promoter, you've gamed the system, now we're getting back at you. But would you agree that if promoters and all these assets have been through several months of efforts by JLFs or lenders to restructure, if they have not succeeded in being able to restructure then, if they are not able to take opportunity of that window of hope that's currently in this ordinance, if we've read the text right, and therefore pay back the overdues at this point in time and be eligible to participate in the process. If both opportunities have been missed, then would you still consider the promoter an actual potential bidder? Because that means he just doesn't have the ability to raise the funds to make a bid, either to restructure the asset before it goes to insolvency or to be able to make himself eligible to be a bidder. In which case, his bid most likely will not be one that is very healthy. So, are we really losing much?
No, I think, Meenka, I think that will depend upon whether it is a bid with a promise to pay in future or it is a bid with cash on the table. If the cash on the table is there, then why does it matter whether in the past he was able to produce it or not? So, and I think the test that Clause C lays down is that has failed to make the payment of all overdue amounts. So it actually envisages actual payment. If the payment is on the table, then problem solved, no?
You weren't able to pay in the past.
Regardless
fine.
Of the history.
No, so you weren't able to pay in the past, fine. We won't be vindictive. We're giving you one opportunity right now, maybe a short time window.
Because I think the pressure, I think it's a question of human psychology. Yeah, I think it's human psychology, because now at this stage the desperation levels will be higher, because it is now within their visibility to see that this asset may be lost to them forever.
Yes.
So with the level of desperation at the inflection point, I think the motivations to find the money will be greater. Isn't
so can't
that obvious?
I say, in fact, can't we argue that this is in fact a masterstroke? It's not ruling you out. It's threatening to rule you out if you don't pay up today. If we are not pushing people now to find money, how many more years are we going to give them, and how much longer should the
Correct.
Rope get? So at some level, it's a masterstroke saying we're not closing the door on you. If you pay up today, great, you're in the room. If you don't pay up today, and if you can't pay up before your asset goes into resolution,
The plane is taking off, and you know this is the last chance before we shut the door.
Yeah.
But you can still sort of make a dash and with your checkbook, and land up there. That's fine. I think that's right. And you call it a masterstroke, but I think, provided it is interpreted correctly, you know that ambiguity that I pointed out.
No, that out, I grant.
I think that needs to be clarified.
To
are
be
we talking
clear.
Of some other? Yeah.
Sir,
yeah, but if you look at it just as a matter of high level principle, if somebody is able to show up at the door with the money, why not?
How long are you going to delay the plane, sir? You picked a beautiful analogy. How long will the plane stay grounded waiting for some promoter VVIP to make his way to
the
door?
No, the plane. No, I think the plane, that is not in anybody's kind of choice, because the timelines in the bankruptcy code are pretty clear. So the plane will leave when it has to leave. But is there a last chance or not? And what is that last chance? How do you define that? I think that is the, that there's an element of pragmatism and fairness in it.
Sir, just have a question specific to whether this entire sort of legal issue could come back to the Reserve Bank of India's doorstep. The one-year timeline that they have used to say that, you know, anybody who's been an NPA for 1 year would not qualify, that essentially is in keeping with what the RBI used to put these accounts into insolvency. That was also, accounts which have been overdue for 1 year and 60% of it are NPA were put into this. That was challenged, I think, by SR. Then that did not hold. If this whole legal process begins again now because of the amendments, could all of those sort of technicalities come into question as well as to how that 1 year period was decided, why 1 year, why not more than that, and many other such technicalities?
I think I have not studied, because I've literally seen it a few hours ago, so I haven't studied that, but potentially yes, some of these questions could arise, but I'd like to apply my mind to it a bit more.
Sure. So, for the, you know, for
so
the
this is exactly
guys.
The sort of what I call the unintended consequences that need to be digested first.
Okay, so for the large assets, I suppose you will find a bunch of bidders. But what about for the small and medium sized assets that are there? You know, if the promoter is not in the fray or is not allowed to participate in the bidding process for the small and medium sized assets, Do you foresee a situation where most of these guys will end up in liquidation? Do you see many cases going down the liquidation route?
Yeah, I think that's a fair point, because this presupposes that absent the promoter, there is sufficient competitive tension and interest in the asset. Whereas there could be situations, particularly the smaller ones, where the promoter may be the only person who's actually interested and nobody else cares about the asset. So that is definitely one problem. But on your second part on liquidation, I think the ordinance also disqualifies them from bidding in the liquidation as well. So they're out.
Oh, that's interesting. So
will be liquidated and then effectively dismantled.
Well, I have one final question then. I think you've expressed you've expressed in your first answer that this is more political messaging than commercial sense. I get that very well. Do you think this was the moment in India that we needed the political message more and that should lead the process? Because for too many years now, promoters have managed to get away with, I won't say gaming the system, but playing with the system, toying with it. Or do you believe that no matter what the excesses were by promoters, commercial wisdom should have always reigned first?
Yeah, I don't want to pass any moral judgment on it. Yes, I think it's a strong political message. And if we were to think of this last window, you know, catch the plane before it takes off, as the commercial mitigant to the political message, it may be actually a good balance of strong political messages showing the will of the state and the determination to get this resolved, and at the same time temper it with one last chance properly defined.
I have one 30-second question to ask you. How many promoters called you between yesterday afternoon and this afternoon, Mr. Shroff? How many have been able to quickly raise funds in the last 24
hours?
Zero.
I'm not taking calls. The only call I took, Menka, was yours. The only call I took was yours.
I can tell you I have zero loans. But Mr. Shroff, I have no doubt your phone's going to be very busy through the course of this weekend. Thank you so much for finding the time to join us this
afternoon. No, we are positioned in this entire bankruptcy space. We're positioned more on the creditors side and potential purchasers, and it's a decision we've taken now. But that being said, as a bankruptcy professional and as a practitioner in this space, I think I'm interested in seeing clarity. I am not interested in seeing ambiguity, because ambiguity will actually kill the very purpose for which this has been designed.
All right, we'll leave it there, Mr. Shroff. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon and for adding more layers
Thank
of
you.
Interpretation to this story, which will be fascinating.